Lucy.
Well, Father?
To be sure, wench, you must have been aiding and abetting, make haste to this escape.
If you can forgive me, sir, I will make a fair confession. For to be sure, Macheath hath been a most barbarous villain to me. Notwithstanding all he swore, I am now fully convinced that Polly Beecham is actually his wife. Did I let him escape, fool that I was, to go to her? I could murder that impudent happy strumpet. I gave him his life, and that creature enjoys the sweets of it. Ungrateful Macheath.
So Polly will wheedle herself into his money, and then Beecham will hang him and cheat us both. Out of my sight, wanton strumpet, go. Stay. Are there any of Peacham's people now in the house?
Filch, sir, is drinking a quart and a strong waters in the next room with Black Moll.
Bid him come to me.
Very well, sir.
Beecham, then, intends to outwit me in this affair by marrying his daughter to Macheath. But I'll turn this affair to my own advantage.
Master Lockett, sir.
Why, Filch, thou lookest as if thou wert half-starved, like a shotten herring.
Well, Black Moll, sir.
Canst thou tell me where thy master is to be found?
Master Beecham, sir, at his lock, sir, at the Crooked Billet.
Beg him to attend me here, for I've many important affairs to settle with him.
I will, Master Lockett.
Found the road so barren of money.
Barren enough.
When my friends are in difficulties, I'm always glad that my fortune can be serviceable to them.
That's a noble
thank you, Captain.
You see, gentlemen, I'm not a mere court friend who professes everything and will do nothing.
The lords of the court so come and are grown that a true friend can hardly be met. Friendship or interest is but a loan which they let out for what they can get. Do you find some friend, some kind, who give you good counsel and self-depend? In sorrowful pity they promise they pity, but shift you for money from friend to friend.
Do you find some friend, some kind, who give you good counsel and self-depend? In sorrowful pity they promise they pity, but shift you for money from friend to friend.
I can serve you, gentlemen. You may command me.
Tonight,
for the benefit of our company, rather than for my own pleasure, I frequent the gaming houses. There will be deep play tonight at Maribone, and consequently money may be picked up upon the road. Has anyone of you seen aught of Beecham?
As we came past Newgate, I saw him enter Lockett's house.
Oh, that bodes no good. No matter. Farewell, gentlemen.
We'll meet at Maribone.
Farewell.
Thank you.
Brother Peachum, those daughters of ours are too slippery hussies. Keep a watchful eye upon Polly, and Macheath in a day or two shall be our own again.
Yeah, that may well be, Brother Lockett. But what signifies catching the bird if your daughter Lucy will set open the door of the cage?
Oh, this is unkind of you, brother.
Sir, here's Mistress Diana Trapes wants to speak with you.
Your servant, gentlemen.
Oh, dear Mistress Trapes, your servant. One may know by your kiss that your gin is excellent.
I was always very curious in me liquors.
There's no perfumed breath like it. I've been long acquainted with the flavour of those lips. Haven't I, Mistress Trapes?
Fill it up. I take as large draughts of liquor as I did of love. I hate to flincher in either. In the days of me youth, I could be like a dove.
In the days of my youth, he could be like a dove. Like a sparrow at all times was ready for love. A fell little laddie, fell little laddie, fell la 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 laddie.
The life of all mortals in kissing should pass.
Fell la 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 la.
The life of all mortals in kissing should pass.
Lip to lip while you're young and the lip to the glass. Fell little laddie, fell little laddie.
But now, Mr. Peachum, to our business. If you have mantles, velvet scarves, petticoats brought in of late, I am your chap.
Why, look here, Mistress Trapes. You deal so hard with us that we can afford to give the gentlemen who venture their lives for their goods little or nothing.
The hard times oblige me to go very near in me dealing. No doubt you know, Mistress Coaxer, there's a wench now till today with a good suit of clothes of mine upon her back, and I could never set eyes upon her for 3 months together. And a meek conscience, nowadays most ladies take a delight in cheating, when they can do it with safety. Yet 'tis I that put the ladies upon a good foot. 'Tis not youth or beauty that fixes their price. The gentlemen always pay according to their dress, from half a crown to 2 guineas. And yet those hussies make nothing of bilking of me. We run great risks indeed.
As I remember, you said something just now of Mistress Coaxer.
Yes, sir, to be sure. I stripped her of a suit of my own clothes about 2 hours ago and have left her as she should be, in a shift, with a lover of hers at my house. She called him upstairs as he was going to Marybone in a hackney coach. And I hope for her own sake and mine, she will persuade the captain to redeem her clothes, for the captain is very generous to the lady.
The captain? What captain?
He thought I didn't know him. An intimate acquaintance of yours, Mr. Peachum? Only Captain Macheath, as fine as a lord.
Ah, Captain Macheath at your house, you say? Tomorrow, dear Mistress Trapes, you shall set your own price upon any of the goods you like. We have at least half a dozen velvet scarves and all at your service. Here, Mr. Lockett and I have a little business with the captain. You understand me. And we'll satisfy you for Mistress Coaxer's debt.
Will you allow Master Peachum and myself to accompany you, madam?
Why, to be sure.
Rage, love, and fear are at once tearing me to pieces.
Oh,
weather-beaten and shattered with distress.
I'm like a skiff on the ocean tossed, now high, now low, with each billow borne, with her rudder broke and her anchor lost, deserted and all forlorn. While thus I lie rolling and tossing all night, that puny lies sporting on seas of delight. Repeat, 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 shall appease my restless sprite. While thus I lie rolling and tossing all night, that puny lies sporting on seas of delight.
I have the ratsbane ready. I run no risk, for I can lay Polly's death upon the gin, and so many die of that naturally that I shall never be called in question. But say I were to be hanged, I never could be hanged for anything that would give me greater comfort than the poisoning that slut.
Madam, here's our Miss Polly come to wait upon you.
Dear madam, your servant.
Yours, dear madam.
Miss Polly, will you give me leave to propose a glass of cordial to you, in the way of friendship?
Strong waters are apt to give me the headache. I hope, madam, you will excuse me.
Oh.
Indeed, I should not have left you in the rude manner I did when we met last, madam, had not my papa hauled me away so unexpectedly. But really, madam, the captain treated me with so much contempt and cruelty that I deserved your pity rather than your resentment.
Away with these melancholy reflections, my dear Polly. Let me prevail upon you to accept of my offer.
Come, sweet lass, let's banish sorrow till tomorrow. Come, sweet lass, let's take a chirpy glass. Wine can clear the vapors of despair and make us light as air, then drink and bath. I can clear the vapors of despair and make us light as air, then drink and banish care. Come, sweet lass, let's banish sorrow till tomorrow. Come, sweet lass, let's take a chirping glass. I can clear the vapors of
bear, child, to see you in such low spirits, and I must persuade you to what I know will do you good. I shall now soon be even with the hypocritical strumpet.
All this wheedling of Lucy's cannot be for nothing. I'll be upon my guard and won't taste a drop of her liquor. I'm resolved.
Come, Miss Polly.
You must, my dear, excuse me.
Really, Miss Polly, you are so squeamishly affected about taking a cup of strong waters as a lady before company. I vow, Polly, I shall take it monstrously ill if you refuse me.
I protest, madam. It goes against me. What do I see here? Macheath, again in custody. Now every glimmer of happiness is lost.
Set your heart to rest, Captain. You are ordered to be called down upon your trial immediately.
Macheath.
Oh, husband.
My dear husband.
Polly,
my dear Macheath.
Lucy.
Away, hussies. This is not a time for a man to be hampered with his wives. You see, the gentleman is in chains already.
Husband, husband, my heart longed to see thee, but to see thee thus distracts me.
Will not my dear husband look upon his Polly? Why hadst thou not flown to me for protection? With me thou hadst been safe.
Dear heart.
what would you have me say, ladies? You see, this affair will soon be at an end without my disobliging either of you.
But the settling this point, Captain, might prevent a lawsuit between your two widows.
Which way shall I turn me? How can I decide? Wife's the day of our death, or as fond as a bride. One wife is too much for most husbands to hear, but two at a time there's no mortal can bear. This way and that way, and which way I will, what would comfort the one other the wife would take ill? This way and that way, and which way I will, what would comfort the one other the wife would take ill?
But if Macheath's own misfortunes have made him insensible to mine, a father, sure, will be more compassionate. Dear, dear father, sink the material evidence and bring him off at his trial. Polly upon her knees begs it of you.
Oh, set your heart at rest, Polly. Your husband is to die to die. Therefore, if you're not already provided, it's high time to look about for another. There's comfort for you, you slut.
If Peachum's heart is hardened, sure you, father, will have more compassion on a daughter.
Aye.
I know the evidence is in your power. How then can you be a tyrant to me?
Macheath, time is come, Lucy. We know our own affairs, therefore let us have no more whimpering or whining. We are ready, sir, to conduct you to the Old Bailey.
Charge is prepared, the lawyers are met, the judge is all arranged, a terrible show. I go undismayed, for death is a debt on demand, so take what I owe. Then farewell, my love, dear Charmers, and you, contented I die, 'tis the best for you. Here ends all dispute, the rest of our lives, for this swear at once I please all my wives.
Now, gentlemen, I am ready to attend you.
Follow them, Filch, to the court, and when the trial is over, bring me a particular account of his behavior and of everything that happened.
I will, Mistress Polly.
You will find me here with Miss Lucy.
Dear Polly.
Dear Lucy.
Some friends of yours, Captain, desire to be admitted.
Bid them come in.
Morning, Captain.
Ah, gentlemen.
Good day, Captain.
Good day, dear.
For my having broke prison, you see, gentlemen, I'm ordered immediate execution.
Oh.
The sheriff's officers, I believe, are now at the door. I beg you, gentlemen, look well to yourselves, for in all probability you may live some months longer.
Aye. We are heartily sorry, Captain, for your misfortune, for it is what we must all come to.
Peacham and Lockett, you know, are infamous scoundrels.
Ah.
Their lives are as much in your power as yours are in theirs.
Ah.
Remember your dying friend.
We will.
It is my last request. Bring those villains to the gallows and I am satisfied.
We'll do it.
Aye, that we will.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Miss Polly and Miss Lucy entreat a word with you, Captain.
Gentlemen, I must bid you farewell.
Farewell, Captain.
Farewell. Captain.
McKeith.
Oh, my dear Lucy.
Oh.
My dear Polly.
Oh.
Whatsoever hath passed between us is now at an end. If you're fond of marrying again, the best advice I can give you is to ship yourselves off for the West Indies.
No.
Where you'll have a fair chance of getting a husband of peace.
Oh, no.
Or by good luck, two or three, as you like best.
Never.
How can I support this sight?
There is nothing moves one so much as a great man in distress.
Would I might be hanged, and I would so do to be hanged with you, my dear.
Wives more, Captain, with a child apiece. See? Here they come.
What? Four wives more? This is too much. Here, tell the sheriff's officers I am ready.
As you will, Captain.
But, honest beggar, I hope you don't intend that McKeith shall be really executed.
Most certainly, sir. To make my opera perfect, I was for doing strict poetical justice.
Why then, friend, this is a downright deep tragedy. The catastrophe is manifestly wrong, for an opera must end happily.
Your objection, sir, is very just, and is easily removed. You rebel there! Run and try a reprieve, and let the prisoner be brought back to his wives in triumph.
A reprieve!
So it seems I'm not left to my choice, but must have a wife at last. Look here, my dears. We will have no controversy now. Let us give this day to mirth. And I'm sure she who thinks herself my wife will testify her joy by a dance.
Hey, dance! 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 Dance!
Thus I stand like the Turk with his doxies around. From all sides their glances his passion confound. For black, brown, or fair, his inconstancy burns. And the different beauties subdue him by turns. Each calls for her chance to provoke his desires. Though willing to all with but one, he retires. But think of his maxim and put off your sorrow. The wretch of